Quill Tree Books and Harper Audio present Exploring the White House, Inside America's Most Famous Home by Kate Andersen Brower. Performed by Patricia Santomasso. A note before we begin. For maps, a timeline, a list of presidents and first ladies, and more, be sure to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/exploring the White House. Living in the White House is like being on the stage, where tragedies and comedies play alternately. And we, the servants of the White House, are the supporting cast. Lillian Rogers Parks, White House maid and seamstress from 1929 to 1961. Introduction. Can you imagine what it would be like to live in the White House? The 55,000 square foot building located at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue in the heart of Washington, D.C., is the country's most famous house. It has been home to 43 presidents. Only George Washington missed out on living there because it hadn't been built yet. And Grover Cleveland was the only president to leave and return for a second term 4 years later. So he was lucky that he got to live in the White House twice. In 1800, President John Adams and First Lady Abigail Adams moved in. Since then, dozens of children have lived in the White House, and one baby was born there. Esther Cleveland was born to President Cleveland and his wife, Frances, in 1893. It may seem glamorous, but it's not always easy to live in the public eye. Lucy Baines Johnson, a daughter of Lyndon B. Johnson, who was president in the 1960s, called the White House a public fishbowl because she had almost no privacy, and she felt like people could look in at her every move. Behind the scenes. The White House is home to just one famous family at a time. The building is the country's most powerful and longest-lasting symbol of the presidency. The nation knows the residents of the White House, the first family, but few know about the dozens of people who work behind the scenes to keep the president's house running. The resident staff rarely get any attention. In fact, most people have no idea they exist, and that's exactly how they like it. The members of the building's supporting cast are its permanent employees, the approximately 100 residence workers who stay on from one administration to the next, regardless of political party. These are chefs, florists, ushers, housekeepers, butlers, engineers, painters, and more who work to make the White House comfortable for the first family. They work long hours. They often sacrifice their personal lives to serve the first family with quiet, awe-inspiring dignity. They do not care if they are working for a Republican president or a Democrat. They treat every first family the same. It's not just a job. It's a calling. And many consider it an honor to serve. Meet the staff. I have been interested in the White House and the people who work and live there since I became a reporter for Bloomberg News during President Barack Obama's first 4 years in office. In my job as a reporter, which was very exciting, I went on trips with the president and the first lady and traveled on the president's plane, which is called Air Force One. Technically, any plane the president is on should be called Air Force One, but really there are only two planes high-tech enough for the job. There are two planes so that one is always ready whenever the president needs it, even at the last minute. When reporters travel with the president, they often become so distracted with the stories they are working on that they forget how historic it is to be sitting on that famous plane. I can remember first hearing the giggles in the press cabin on board the blue and white Boeing 747-200B as about 20 of my fellow reporters and I caught a glimpse of the Obama's fluffy and playful Portuguese water dog running down the aisle from the front of the plane. The dog's name is Bo, and at the time, he was just 3 years old and having fun on the country's most historic airplane. We all looked up from our laptops and our phones for a few wonderful minutes and took in the scene as a White House resident staffer desperately tried to summon the rascally Bo, his white paws bounding up and down the aisle and his tongue and tail wagging happily, back to the front of the plane where his family was waiting for him. The Obamas were traveling to Martha's Vineyard for summer vacation, and they brought their dog along for the ride. It was one of the rare moments when I caught a glimpse of the people who serve the first family but are rarely ever seen. It also reminded me that the president and his family are just like the rest of us. They like having their dog around to play with too. And sometimes their pets don't follow the rules either. No matter what job you have someday, always be sure to take the time to look around you and soak in the special parts of it. In 2011, I was invited to a luncheon with First Lady Michelle Obama, along with about a dozen other reporters who covered the First Lady. I was nervous and excited. Lunch was served in the small and cozy old family dining room. It would be a huge room in any normal size house, but everything in the White House is built on a grand scale, and this is one of the smaller rooms. It is also a private room tucked away from public view. I had never seen this private side of the White House. I didn't even know the room existed. An elegantly dressed gentleman offered us champagne on a gleaming silver tray, and Michelle Obama called him by his first name. The menu included salad with vegetables from the White House garden, which the First Lady had created, and fresh pan-roasted fish elegantly presented on the Truman china. It's called the Truman china because the pattern for the dinnerware was picked out by President Harry Truman and his wife, Bess. In modern times, most administrations choose their own china. Each course was served by the butler, who clearly had a wonderful relationship with the First Lady. "This is all very elegant, like being an English princess," I thought. This experience, coupled with watching the aide try to convince Bo to head back to his seat on Air Force One, left me wondering, who were these people, so close to the world's most powerful family? So I made it a mission to find out who they were. Many people told me it would be impossible to get them to talk about their experiences, but they were wrong. Never let someone tell you that something can't be done. In my research, I interviewed dozens of current and former resident staff who have devoted themselves to caring for the first families. They are the housekeepers and butlers, the chefs, florists, plumbers, and painters, who are all incredibly proud of their work and who stay in their jobs for decades, serving the institution of the American presidency and not one particular president. They are not Democrats or Republicans, they told me. They are Americans. This is an important and often ignored part of our incredible democracy, and I'm excited for you to meet these loyal and hardworking people. Each staffer who has served at the White House has seen history, and each has incredible stories to tell. This book shares what they have taught me about the traditions and rituals of the White House, as well as some of what they have witnessed behind the scenes. Chapter 1. 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, the most famous house in the country. Standing in front of 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, the White House looks like a grand three-story mansion. But it's really much more than meets the eye. The White House actually has 8 floors, 6 full levels, and 2 mezzanines, or partial floors. It boasts 132 rooms, 147 windows, 35 bathrooms, 28 fireplaces, 8 staircases, and 3 elevators. And on these 8 floors are some pretty unusual rooms, not normally found in a regular house. For example, while the main kitchen is located on the ground floor, there is also a flower shop and a carpenter shop. The first floor, also called the state floor, is the main level, where visitors can explore during guided tours. The chief usher's office and the pastry kitchen are tucked in between the state floor and the second and third floors, which are the first family's private quarters. There are also several levels of basements and underground spaces. History in every room. Special events have happened in almost every room of the White House. Consider the Lincoln bedroom on the second floor. When Abraham Lincoln was president, it was actually his office and not his bedroom. In that room, Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, which freed slaves in the South in 1863. He said he had never felt more certain that I was doing right than I do in signing this paper. It was a long process, though, and slavery did not officially end until December 1865, when the 13th Amendment to the Constitution ended slavery everywhere in the United States. Lincoln's dedication to holding the country together and defeating slavery has made him one of the most important presidents in United States history. A copy of the legendary document can be found in the Lincoln bedroom. Citizens would gather in the nearby Treaty Room and wait for a chance to meet with the president in his office. But Lincoln built a private passage so he could cut through the Treaty Room to go to his library in the Yellow Oval Room without dealing with the crowds waiting to see him. He walked right by his visitors. But because of a partition erected in the Treaty Room, they could not see him as he shuttled between his office, now the Lincoln bedroom, and the Yellow Oval Room. He would see them when he was ready. Citizens can no longer walk into the White House and visit with the president. Instead of serving as a public waiting room, the Treaty Room is now a private room and a presidential study. It got its name because a famous peace treaty with Spain was signed there in 1898. It is also where President John F. Kennedy signed the Limited Nuclear Test Ban Treaty in 1963. Each floor has a room shaped like an oval. The diplomatic reception room on the ground floor, where President Franklin Delano Roosevelt delivered his fireside chats, and where the first family usually enters the residence. The blue room on the state floor, which overlooks the South Lawn and features a beautiful glass French chandelier and vivid blue satin draperies. And the yellow oval room on the second floor, which leads to the Truman balcony. There are four staircases in the residence itself. The grand staircase, which goes from the state floor to the private second floor. A staircase by the president's elevator, which goes from the basement to the third floor. A spiral staircase by the staff elevator, which goes from the first floor mezzanine to the basement. And a fourth staircase, the true back stairs, which runs from the second floor by the queen's bedroom, an elegant rose-colored room named for royalty who have stayed there, to the east end of the third floor. Maids sometimes use this staircase if they need to clean rooms on the second floor and want to avoid interrupting the first family. It allows them to walk all the way up to the third floor and circle back down. There are also secret rooms that most people don't talk about. The underground locker rooms where butlers keep their tuxedos and maids house their uniforms are just a short distance from a bomb shelter under the East Wing that was built for President Franklin Delano Roosevelt during World War II. This room is now the President's Emergency Operations Center, built to withstand a nuclear blast. It is a tube-shaped bunker where the president may be taken in case of an attack. Home sweet home. But despite all these different official rooms, ultimately, the White House is a home to the first family. The White House is built on a human scale, said Tricia Nixon Cox, the eldest daughter of President Richard Nixon and First Lady Pat Nixon. One day, after a welcoming ceremony on the South Lawn, a visiting European prince turned to Tricia and said, "It really is a house." He had been astonished by the scale of the executive mansion compared with the palaces he knew. To him, it looked small. The White House may be less imposing than some royal palaces, but it is far from modest. The large entrance hall on the north side opens to the 80-foot-long East Room at one end and the State Dining Room, often used for state dinners in honor of foreign heads of state, at the other. In fact, early presidents and first ladies complained that the house was too big. It was considered the largest house in the United States until after the Civil War. Around Inauguration Day, almost every guest room is crammed with friends and family. Taxpayers spent about $230,000, roughly $4 million.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.